So hello, welcome back to a new video. Today we want to talk a little bit about the new Sony SDK that they have released, which I have mixed feelings about. And as a technical person, so I write software and work in hardware, I want to explain why I'm a little bit upset about it and what I think is the problem and how I can explain it to non-technical people why I think this won't open up the floodgates to more development on Sony. So before we get going, let me say two things. First, many people have already noticed I have this little doll always here, which was a small present from Smolvik a few years ago. And I just put it there to remind me to say, hopefully everything is going well in China and hopefully the virus is getting under control. I see that the numbers are going down, but let's hope that it all works out, because it will definitely, of course, affect people, which is the most important, but also quite a few of the things that we are doing and the things that we are getting from that area in the world. So let's get going. The second thing that I want to sort of mention, I'm still trying to work out on this new setup where I'm sort of like this overlay and working with the lower thirds. So if you want to subscribe, please do. If you want to go to our Facebook group, which is called Sony Full Frame Setup Tips, where we, without judgment and trying to keep it clean, so no picture posting, no unboxing sort of videos, and we try to protect people, so no open attacks to people. So if you want to join that, please do. And after we have done that, let's jump into the problem. So let's first recap a little bit why this is sort of moving backwards. And I want to make a few points and hopefully that works out for everybody. First thing there, we had an SDK before. So what happened is that a few years ago, most of the Sony cameras were running on Android. So basically one of the OSs, of course you have Apple and we have Google, and Google phones are running on Android, and all the Sony cameras up to, I think, the 6300 or the 6500 were running on Android. And you can notice that because we were able to install applications on the camera. It was not a big success, so Sony removed it. And to make the cameras faster and make them more, integrated, they decided to move back to a pure Linux version. So that's why we left, we lost all of the applications. And one mistake that people are making is that they think that this SDK is about writing applications on the cameras. Sorry to say, as far as I can tell, and I'm actually agreeing with that, I don't think we will ever see applications in the way that they were before coming back to these cameras. So that's point one. So the second point, and that's why I call this the history of the API. So an API, when we are talking about it, we are talking about an application programming interface so that developers can actually talk to a device, so in this case, a camera. So normally we would do that over some kind of a protocol or directly. And that's one of the issues we are going to talk to about today by looking at a few of the examples in the documentation, but also trying to explain where I think they made a mistake and what the consequences are of this mistake. So actually 2 years ago they stopped development on that. So when they kicked out the Android operating system, they basically already had up and running. You could become a member and you could download the SDK similar than this one, and you could help in the development of applications both on the camera and off the camera. They stopped it because they changed everything. And I think that was probably a good idea. And when asking them over the last, let's say, 1.5 years, when will you open this up again? They said pretty soon, pretty soon. And I guess this week it happened because they released an SDK. The way that I did it is kind of the old way that they did it before. And there are many downsides to it. So that's why we wanted to talk about this. So what we will do is I will quickly by showing you part of the documentation, show you what the problems are and how to think about it, how it looks to a developer, if that makes sense. So let me quickly jump into the documentation by, I have to press a few buttons and then do something like this. And there we have some of the documentation. So basically you can download the software, and one of the problems, and let me zoom in, then you can sort of see what we are talking about. So this is a sketch of how it sort of works. So basically what you need to do is, you're not directly talking to the camera. So you see on the left side a program. The program is not talking directly to the camera. Most of the time is first talking, in this drawing is a little bit confusing, you're talking to an SDK, and the SDK is actually running on a host computer. In this case, they only released it for Windows, which is already weird, and they released it in a programming language called C++. And that means that you are already limiting your scope of what you can do. And that is one of the major problems that we as developers have, is we actually don't want to talk to something in between. We want to talk directly to the camera. So the second thing that they did, they only released the protocol for USB, and they didn't unify, or at least make an overlapping sort of system where we can talk to all the interfaces. So Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, USB, Ethernet, and basically combine them. And that is very useful. For example, the new application that they use for themselves, so the Edge application, actually uses Bluetooth to kind of start up the camera, because that has low power. Then it tells it, hey, here's the Wi-Fi connection, please connect to the Wi-Fi connection of the camera, and then you start talking to it. So the reason why they didn't do that is, my gut feeling is that they had an application over the up running on Windows, and they decided, maybe for Adobe, maybe for some other the developer, to open that part up. And they didn't go for what most developers, if you look at the forums, are asking for an open API that we can talk to. And what I mean with that is that you, let me go back to the camera. So if we look at the camera, let me put this like this. So if you are looking at the camera, basically what we want to be able to directly talk to one of the interfaces on here. Now that is possible, but it's basically hidden. So if you go back to the drawing, you can see that the commands in the middle, what we really want to know, are basically written in a language that we can't understand. So let me scroll, and hopefully we find some more pictures in the documentation. I did not prepare this as usual. But here, for example, you see all the commands that we can sort of now do. So that's quite nice. You can program it. But let me scroll and see if we can find another nice picture. Yep, this is a nice picture. Let's zoom into this one. So basically what you see is the user somehow connects to this SDK. And the SDK is basically in turn talking to the camera. And basically, if you see the big sort of arrow with the two points to it, that's the protocol that we actually want to know. And that's the protocol that we really want to understand, and we want them to make easy. And with easy, I mean that we don't have to reverse engineer it, because it's now a big garble of numbers, basically. And what we really want is a system that's human readable. So, and for that, there's lots of examples. So, for example, if I'm talking to my Hue lights, I can already talk almost like a human, or at least in human language, I can talk to this camera. So, let's say I want to talk to this camera, I could use the web protocols, which is quite normal. So, you would basically have a web server running in your device. So, for example, your Hue lights, and you talk to that web interface, and you give it almost human-like commands. For example, you could say camera number one / focus / F8, right? And you could say okay, or you could say camera number one / ISO ? Right? And then it would tell you, return to you your ISO value. So these human readable commands would make it much more easy for developers to talk to these devices. And that's actually what we want, because that means that we can use quite basic tools on many more platforms to quite easily start hacking with this interface. So if we go back to what's on the table to show you two examples, or what could then be used, is you see basically in this case I have a Windows stick on there. So theoretically I could now install it on that, then write a little bit of software on that, and that could control then the camera, right? So this one has two USB ports, as you can see. It's a Windows 10 stick, but it takes quite a lot of power. It's not very stable, and I doubt if there will be any hardware maker that is willing to put this in a small piece of hardware that, for example, we could use in our pocket, or even have it hooked up into some nice interface. I can imagine I could theoretically talk to SmallRig and, hey, I have this small sort of Linux box that I want to use, and as a what we call a gateway that's able to create a web interface, for example, to my camera, that I can use it by hooking it up to the USB on one side and then hooking it up to this small box. So I doubt that anyone will do that on a Windows platform. It just won't. So this one, in my opinion, is out, although theoretically it would work. So what would be better is something, a box like this. Now this is quite a big one. This is a Raspberry Pi. So this is basically Linux. And why is that important? Because if I would be able to use these types of boxes without installing a lot of libraries, because it is possible. I'm not saying it's not possible, because now that they open up this SDK, the reverse engineering will be easier. So with reverse engineering, I mean the big gray arrow will be easier to decode a little bit. We can figure out what they are doing and then somehow come up with our own command set so that we can talk to it. This human, almost human readable sort of commands, and talking to the camera and getting somewhat sensible commands back from the camera. But if we do that ourselves, it will never be standardized, and I think that's a bad idea. I think they should not have done that, and I think that makes it more difficult, because if they would not if they would do it the other way, so just using a human readable and almost web-based or internet-based protocols, that would be way nicer for us to talk to it. So what we would call as developers, let me switch to the other one. When we were talking about direct API, so what we are talking about, the proxy libs for version direct API. So normally what you would be able to do is directly talk to the camera in something of a web-based protocol way. So that makes it much easier. What they have now done is basically release what they call SDK, which you install on Windows, and then the developers need to talk to that SDK. Then it goes into this magical sort of mumble jumble that maybe we can decode, right? Somebody might do it, and that one talks to the camera, while they should have done it talking directly to the camera. So more in these kinds of standards. Now, you probably, I made it so big that you can't even see it. Okay. So basically, if you're a web developer, you probably are familiar with some of these terms. So what we want is that they basically modernize it and bring it up to, let's say, 2018 to 2020 specs, that the camera itself, we should be able to connect to it using internet-based protocols, so HTTP, HTTPS, SFTP maybe, UDP, there are different ways of doing it, being able to address it. And I was just talking about, and I'm doing this like this //, because everybody sort of recognizes it, way of talking to the camera. Why is that important? Because as a developer, you also want to be able to easily debug things, right? So if I'm talking to a REST-based device, I can just in my browser or using quite an easy tool, which is easy to install on all platform, kind of send commands to the camera, and for example say, camera shutter on, camera shutter off, just in a web URL. And we can also do that in software. And it could return to me, like, which is a normal web language, it could say 200, okay, I understood it and I did it. Or it could say 403, you're not allowed to do this, and then you probably get a reason. This is something that many developers are using on a daily basis, and that will be much smarter. For open connections, they could something called WebSocket, so I put it here as WebSocket, if we want to keep communicating. So for example, let's say you want to know the audio levels of a camera, right? So we are in video mode, let me turn this off. So we are in video mode, and we want to have the audio levels so that we can display them in a web interface, for example, which would be really doable. Then we just need to know the level. We don't need to have the sound, the sample itself. We just need to know the level, which is not that much. And you could use something like WebSockets, which is quite a well understood interface, to talk back to my application, which could then be running on my phone or on a little box or on anything that we can sort of come up with, because it's in this almost English for the web sort of language and not in some foreign language that nobody sort of understands. The last one I put on there was JSON, and JSON would be I'm not saying it's my favorite thing, but JSON is something which is extremely popular. Again, almost human readable sort of commands or data sets that you can send from a device to your box or to your phone, etc., etc. So what would happen if they would do that? That would, in my opinion, mean that many more people which have boxes like this, which I'm not suggesting are the end result, but are development tools. And so this is a Raspberry Pi. It costs about 50 euros. I put it in a nice box, and you can see it has Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, Ethernet. So this makes it perfect to develop applications and to test applications. And once you have this, you can then go into a much smaller Linux piece of hardware, or even specially built hardware, and then turn it into a flash controller or something else, right? So this is a first step, making it way easier to do this development. So yeah, that's kind of my rant about this, that I really hope that Sony sort of comes to the conclusion that this is, in a way you could say, you're getting an SDK, what are you complaining? And yes, there seem to be some interesting commands in there. But the problem is the direction that they are going is not the direction that I think makes sense. And I'm really doubtful and kind of scared, in fact, that that they will build into the camera itself, let's say, these open, well-documented, and I would argue human-readable sort of APIs. They might, but I have highly my doubts, because they kind of have set the direction. So the best thing we can hope for, let's go back to the other picture, so this one. The best that we can hope for is basically that we will get a description of this gray arrow, which are still very human unreadable commands, but at least that they will provide us an easier way to translate from, let's say, these normal languages, so the English type of human readable languages, into this protocol, and they open that part up. So that does not resolve everything, but at least then I could, for example, quite easily use build an iPhone app, which then uses this library, and somebody will probably port it into JavaScript and port it into Java and port it into Python and PHP or whatever language we can up with. Once that translation engine is there and they open it up, that seems to be the best thing that we can hope for, because I doubt that they will do it directly into the camera, as I was talking about before, which I think would have been the best step forward, in my opinion. And just to round this up in a way, that would not have been weird. It would not been much heavier in implementing, because on the A7 R4, which is this one, and the A9, they already kind of started doing that using the FTP protocol, which is also a human readable protocol. So I basically can say, hey, open a connection to this camera. what's in the memory of this camera. I can say put a file on the server. I can say remove a file from the server. So these are human readable commands. So they already have shown by implementing much more of the FTP protocols that they are able to do this. And I think it's a mistake that they made it binary again and closed it up again. And I really hope that Sony, on a software update, reverses that and makes open human readable protocols. So that I think what will happen then is that we will see many applications, including for me, right? Because I think it will be fun take, for example, this box, turn this into a box that over, for example, USB, if that needs to be, connect to the camera, and then on this one, I will probably install a web server, which is already there, install a web server so that I can use my phone to connect to it and to start fiddling around with it, make applications, and do things that people are asking for, like being able to do panorama shots or doing different focus stacking ideas, or for video, being able to, that would be nice, right? So you have this small box, you connect it up to one or multiple cameras, which is probably doable to do it on multiple at the same time, because, well, we have four USB ports here, so four USB ports. Theoretically, I could hook this up to four cameras, and then be able to, on my phone, because this then would then be running a web server, I would go to this phone and be able to control them. Simple things like see their audio levels or see a screenshot for, let's say, every second, because you can do a live view. Or do other commands that I think would be very interesting to start researching or to start fiddling with before we get into creating real products. And I think, this is kind of a missed opportunity that they are not doing it. So when people started sending me the direct messages and showing me this link, I already saw it and already commented on some of the forums. I am not overly happy with what they have done. For this reason, because I think the barriers that they threw up, so it is Windows only over USB, using this proxy method, so basically a translator sort of thing, which requires libraries to need to be installed, again, only on Windows, over USB, and not this direct sort of mechanism, I think it will scare most people or keep most developers away. And I think it's a really big missed opportunity. And hopefully they will reverse this or at least open it up in such a way that it makes it easy for others to create at least this translation software, so that we go from this human readable control mechanisms to this camera which talks in this Chinese, Japanese, non-human readable language, computer language. So that's basically what I want to say. So hopefully it was not too long for people. See you in the next one. I'm also still using new stuff in the making these videos. So tell me what you think. I think I look still a little bit red, but that's what I look like. And also playing around with the audio, which is now handled by a new box. So tell me if this sounds okay. And hopefully this video was useful for you. I will talk to the Sony people that I know. I will try to convince them again about the point about opening up these APIs and these protocols, because I actually think this is a step backwards compared to where we were 2 years ago and not forward. Now, there is good news, and the good news, of course, is that the development has been opened up again. There are clear hints that they are investing time in it. I'm just not sure why they did it this way. I'm hoping it's because of their Windows, their own tethering application, that they decided to open up that part, and they have more plans to open up things. We are also seeing things, and there's also positive in this API that about new formats, for example. So we might see some interesting hints in the software already about what is coming. But on a practical level, I hope that this is the first step and definitely not the last step, and that they soon, like they did with the mount, tell us, hey, we will open it up, and this is the way that we are going to do it. So, yeah, thank you for watching, and see you in the next one. Bye-bye.